Hello, welcome to Underlords Universe, where we like to chit chat about all kinds of stuff that inspires us to be creative in our own right. And just a quick comment, you know, we just put out a single. It's called Ordo Obstrusus Oculus. We're going to put a little link down below. We were really lucky to get a former Iron Maiden vocalist, Blaze Bayley, to do a vocal for it. We think it turned out really well. Please check it out. Hope you like it.
How did you get Blaze
Like
Bayley?
and
Is it okay to ask about that story?
say what?
How did you get Blaze Bayley to sing on your song? That just seems like there's a story there.
it's really not terribly complicated. It's just
he called us and said, "Hey, I want to sing this song." And we said, "Okay, right?"
Yeah, right. No, in all seriousness, it was just simply just emailing his manager. There's a little thing on his website.
Okay.
That I noticed, and I just emailed the manager and then went from there. So
okay.
It was actually really slick, really easy to do, but yeah,
that's so cool.
He was great. Yeah. So, you know, but and you know, you're involved in all kinds of creative stuff, and you're inspired by some of the same stuff that we're inspired
Absolutely.
By. So if you're just stumbling across us, Dr. Music over here, that's Brent, I'm Bryon. This is Josh, the great Sun Jester, and our esteemed guest, Joan Crawford, also Bryon as well. So
just make things clear.
Yeah, just to make things clear, yeah. So we're doing part two of a multi-part discussion on the discography of Bloister Cult, because they've been a big influence to all of us. The first part, we did the first five Bloister Cult albums. This is the second five, which is going to focus on Mirrors, Cultosaurus Erectus, Fire of Unknown Origin, Revolution by Night, and Club Ninja. And like I said, Brian's joining us for this conversation. He was with us on the first one. We'll put a link below if you are interested in seeing part one. And Bryon is a co-host of a great podcast called Hair Metal Memories. I just listened today to their recent episode. That's the most recent episode, right?
That's the most recent one. Yep.
On Alice Cooper's Constrictor. Highly informative, highly entertaining. It's also a member of the band Strong Like Bear. So he's involved in all kinds of stuff, right? So, yeah.
I have fun.
You guys have any thoughts or comments before we dig into the second of the Bloister Cult catalog we're looking at?
No.
Don't be too exciting, guys. Don't be too excited.
No.
Keep it down.
I'm ready to go.
Yeah. I had a small zeitgeist moment this week where I just started reading the new memoir by Thurston Moore from Sonic Youth. And he mentions really early on how he went and saw a Blue Oyster Cult show, but he had a miserable time at it.
I know. How's that possible?
I didn't think it was possible either. Yeah, and it sounds like it was mostly like the crowd and stuff like that ruined it for him. I don't think it was the band itself. It was like the scene.
that of course, you know, can happen. I Josh, you and I went and saw Blue Oyster Cult. 93, fall of 93. It was Wishbone Ash, Uriah Heep, Bloister Cult, and Nazareth.
Yep. Wow, that's a show.
Yeah. And the crowd was a little, I don't know.
Out there, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. There was a fight that broke out. Like, it was in a ballroom in Davenport. Yeah. So, but yeah. And I remember at the time thinking, how many times are we going to be able to see Bloister Cult? You know, and as it turns out, it's lots.
Lot,
you know,
and a few we've seen them a few times.
Yeah, Bryon, have you seen B.O.C. a few times yourself, or
just once when they played in Des Moines at the State Fair? That's the only opportunity I've had while I was you know had the time and had the money and all that stuff. Yeah. But I was so happy I got to see them, and I would happily go see them again.
Yeah,
they were great.
Well, and as a coinkidink, that was also if that's the same fair. Oh, wait a minute. Which fair show? Was it the free show that they did at the fair?
The free one.
Oh, yeah. Okay. That was a really good show. Yeah.
That was a good show.
They were on fire. They also opened. The reason I paused there was because they had opened for Alice Cooper at the Grandstand like the year before.
Oh, wow.
So
I'd go to that too.
Yeah. So at any rate, let's just go ahead and dig into this. Just a quick comment about our system here. So we each award the songs on the albums points on a 5-point scale, and then we divide by the total number of tracks for an average, and divide by the total points possible for a percentage. That way we try to keep ourselves as objective as possible as we try to quantify the qualitative, which is always problematic, but it's the system we decided to use just for fun. We kind of want to see if our preconceived notions about how we'd rank albums match up to some sort of reasonably objective scale. So we're starting, what we're going to do is we're going to go through and just briefly kind of discuss each album. And then at the end, we'll kind of disclose how we ended up ranking all of these. So, so of this set, so Mirrors would be the sixth Bloister Cult studio album, right? Mm-hmm. That fabulous cover art that they did whatever the heck that is there. But this album, this was produced by Tom Werman, and it's the only album produced by Tom Werman by Bloister Cult. And it, you know, it comes off the heels of a couple of really big hits for them, right? They did, you know, Agents of Fortune, Spectres, the live album also, Some Enchanted Evening, was a huge, huge record. This album did not sell anywhere near what I think they were expecting. How do you guys, like, does that kind of surprise you? Do you look at this album and say, this is great, this should have been a hit, or do you kind of go, I kind of get why this wasn't such a hot album?
I kind of get it.
Oh really? Okay.
Yeah,
I don't get it at all. I love this record.
Do you?
I should have been a lot bigger than what it was. I think it's fantastic.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Yeah, Josh.
You know, I love this record. It scored better than Spectres did, but getting to the commercial impact of it, I mean, what's the single? What's the single off this album?
Well, there was actually four singles if you count. Moon Crazy was released as a single in Japan, that's a strange choice. But Dr. Music, the title track Mirrors was a single, I believe.
And I remember that on the radio back in the day, and it's still one of my favorite songs. But I think that, you know, when I ask what's the single, I don't know if there's not really a Don't Fear the Reaper or a Godzilla on this album. I don't know if it has quite the, and I'm not saying that makes it a worse album. I love this record. I just don't know if I hear it being quite as commercial as the last two albums they did.
You're
right. There is no song on this record that had that impact, unfortunately. I think there should have been, but there wasn't. Yeah.
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 Great record, though. I think through most of it, it's a really consistent album. It's got, you know, we talk a lot about high points and low points. Great Sun Jester. You can see I've kind of pulled that moniker for myself for this discussion because I love that song. For me, I ranked that at five. Mirrors, the title track, always been a favorite. Love that. Gave that a five. The Vigil, that's a five. There's a lot of really great songs. For me, the album is a little anticlimactic with how it ends. The last two songs, they're okay. You know, I think it ends a little soft. But, you know, overall, really a very listenable album all the way through. Really, really like this one.
So, okay, you mentioned The Vigil. The Vigil's my, if I had to pick, like, one song from this record, it would be The Vigil. It'd be a hard decision because I love Dr. Music. The Vigil, it just goes through so many different
moods,
and I love that. It's very,
it does
kind of proggy in that regard. And to me, you know, that's a great example of a song where it's like, this can't be a single. You can't make The Vigil a single. Right. But man,
it's the longest song on the album.
Right. Yeah.
It's like 6.5 minutes long.
Right. But I love The Vigil. I would say this. I think In V is a great song too.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, it's interesting. They're starting to get different influences in the writing and stuff. And even in the song In V, you know, there's this kind of peculiar line that says, Jim says some destinies should not be delivered. And that is apparently a reference to Jim Carroll from the Jim Carroll Band and a song called Day and Night.
Oh, nice.
Which is interesting because Jim Carroll ends up co-writing.
So he comes back. He'll come up again.
He comes up again. Yeah. Yeah. So, you know, and in the Great Sun Jester is kind of based on Michael Moorcock's novel, the Fire Clown, which Josh, you're really into, you know, a lot of fiction and stuff. Have you read?
You know, I'm not dived into Michael Moorcock yet. I have a few of his books and it's on my list to get into, but that kind of pulpy classic sci-fi fantasy, you know, I definitely love him. He's a huge name. So interesting reference there.
Yeah. Yeah. Brian, have you ever read any Michael Moorcock?
I've read a lot of Michael Moorcock. Yeah. He was early on, he was one of my favorite writers. So when I saw that, he's worked with Blue Oyster Cult and he's also worked with Hawkwind.
Oh, no kidding.
Yeah. He wrote some of the lyrics with Hawkwind and he also has at least one album out under his own name where he got all of his musician friends to help him out. But, most of his writing is around, he created this character called the Eternal Champion. And so he has multiple fantasy series and each one of them has the hero of the book, but they're all a version of the same character. Yeah. And so but they're all radically different. So like they read like they're completely different, but there's like, but every now and then the characters will kind of like show up and stuff like that. So he has like this weird loose continuity thing going on.
Is the Fire Clown related to that particular character that you're referring to, or is that a separate?
I don't think so. I think it's a separate thing. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. He has some character. He writes a bunch of other stuff. If you look at his bibliography, it's enormous. He's been, he cranks them out, man.
Well, I remember a neighbor of ours growing up, I think was into Michael Moorcock, and it was kind of always a name that was floating around, but I still have never bothered to pick any of it up, but maybe I will.
Yeah. Yeah, it's pretty good. His biggest one is Elric, the Elric series, and Elric is kind of a messed up character because he's like this skinny albino and he has to take all these drugs just to survive and all this stuff. So he's kind of an anti-hero in a lot of ways.
Yeah,
and his sword is like possessed and he needs to feed his sword's souls, and so he in order for him to gain power he has to kill people with his sword. So
sounds kind of like a sword with maybe a black blade.
Yeah.
Oh gosh, I don't want to get ahead of us. I don't want to get ahead of us.
Right.
Yeah, Michael Moorcock also will come up again.
Say one thing about this record.
Yeah. We should probably get back to the record.
Yeah, sorry.
Yeah. Go ahead.
I have 6 5-star songs on this record.
Really?
6.
Wow.
Yeah. 6.
Okay.
That's impressive.
Can I guess what they are?
You can try. Sure.
Dr. Music.
Yes.
Mirrors.
Yes.
The Vigil.
Yes.
I Am the Storm.
Yes.
Envy.
Yes.
Well, I got 5 out of 6 because that's where I'm dropping off.
Great Sun Jester.
Oh, I thought I said that. I thought, I'm sorry. Okay. Okay.
And I almost gave it to You're Not the One I Was Looking For. Because I love that song. So
interesting. Sick. That's a low point for me. That's actually one of the low points on that album for me.
I had to say I love the record sounds. I like the production. I love the songs. I think everybody in the band is really contributing at this point. I mean, Alan Lanier wrote "In Thee," which I think was a song that might have been maybe their biggest song on the record if they had one. But I think they're firing on all cylinders on this record. And
Okay. On the whole, Brian, I mean, do you tend to agree that that's, or do you see the album as a little more patchy, a little hit and miss?
This one, I mean, I love it because I love all the B.O.C. albums, but this one's kind of low for me. To me, it sounds like they're trying too hard. It sounds like they've had a taste of success and now they're trying to, like you mentioned, You're Not the One I Was Looking For. That sounds like, it reminds me of like Since You've Been Gone or something like that, where they're trying to write a pop hit, And I think when they try to do something that they don't normally do, you can kind of hear it.
I think the song was actually written as a joke. I believe that song was a takeoff of another song, and it was kind of intended as a tongue-in-cheek kind of a joke thing.
Oh.
The song it was based off of, but I believe there's a story behind that.
And that just, for me, that's why I like doing these conversations because like I've never heard that, and it makes me say, oh, I'm gonna go listen to that song again and maybe listen to it with a new, you know, a new point of view. Yeah,
knowing it's a joke, I should listen to it again. Maybe I'd like it more.
Right.
What would you... I'm pretty sure there's a story behind that. And I think the song works really well within the context of the record. I'm not particularly fond of Only Teardrops, Moon Crazy, but I do think the sequencing of the record and the songs kind of work together. And I'm sorry to interrupt, Brian. But
No, you're fine. Yeah. So, Brian, what would you say is a high point then for you? Like, you're on like
The Vigil. I agreed with you on The Vigil, actually. To me, that's the one that sounds the most like, you know, what I think of as Blue Oyster Cult. That checks all the boxes for me as being a song that sounds like that. So that's the one I rated the highest. I gave it a 3.8 because I thought this one is the most, you know, like what it didn't sound like they were stepping outside of the, you know, the box and trying too hard.
Yeah.
They were just doing what they're really good at.
Yeah, this to me, I always thought this album was a bit of peaks and valleys, but with more peaks than valleys. So the peaks really carried it, but I do think that there's some spots. I'm not a big fan of Moon Crazy. I'm not a fan of You're Not the One I Was Looking For or Lonely Teardrops. But
yeah, same.
Yeah, I Am the Storm, I think, is a really, really, really solid track.
That's a classic Blue Oyster Cult too, I think. Mm-hmm. You know,
it's got
those were the two, The Vigil and I Am the Storm. I rated the highest on that album. Mm-hmm. And I really like The Great Sun Jester a lot too. That melodically, it sounds like the Beatles to me. I mean, it's kind of
I can hear that.
Very, very melodic, you know.
And the title track is so catchy, just so, you know, it's just so infectious.
It's super catchy.
I could see that the title track being a bit controversial, though, because you know, I could see somebody saying, "Well, yeah, gosh, that chorus." I mean, I actually love the song too, but I could see somebody saying, "Gosh, those vocals and the chorus just gets in my head, and it's just like nails on a chalkboard or something," you know? But you know, personally, I love it. But it was, like we said, it was produced by Tom Werman,
who's the hit maker.
He's
known for that.
He is known for that now, and I don't want to take anything away from the guy because I don't know, but and he has a new book out too, which I intend to read. Don't have yet, but I one of these days I'm going to pick it up. But
I just read an interview with him about that book, I kind of want to pick it up now too, because he talks about how he's mostly wanting to set the story straight, because he worked with all these bands, and at the time they were all like, you know, basically kissing his ass and saying, we're so glad you're helping us and making this record, everything sounds great, we're so excited, you know, they start making money off the albums they made with him. And then, you know, you fast forward in time when some of this production is a little out of style now. Now the bands throw him under the bus and say like, oh, well, we had Tom Werman on this and, you know, he ruined our record and everything. He says they did not feel like that at the time, and he's hurt by it because he felt like they were friends, you know.
Yeah, well, and that would be interesting to read, because I mean, whether I like these bands or not, some of those albums he produced were massive.
Yeah,
and it's
he
like
was the guy.
Yeah, and of course, yeah, that some of that production sensibility is going to maybe be a little dated, but you take it for what it is. It was a sign of the times, right?
Right. Yeah, it is.
What I thought was interesting, and Brian, I don't know if you know Kirk Kaufman from
Junior's Motel.
And he, you know, his band back in the day, the Hawks,
mm-hmm.
their first album was produced by Tom Werman.
And, oh wow, I did not know that.
Yeah.
That's cool.
And I don't want to put words in anybody's mouth. My memory could be completely wrong on this, but I kind of remember being up there at that studio. And I recall him telling us that Tom Werman basically just kind of sat around and read the paper and didn't do a whole lot as a producer.
Oh, wow.
And, you know, but again, whether I'm remembering that accurately or not, you know, or whether he was remembering it accurately or not, you know, so that's why I'm interested in reading his book is just kind of those reasons. But yeah, did you guys have like I came out with Mirrors? For me, Mirrors came out at 3.88. Did you have a a number. No, I didn't.
We're gonna do it until the end. Try to stick.
That's okay. That's okay.
Oh, yeah. Four. Mine was 4.44.
4.44.
Yep.
Cool.
That's what you want.
Yeah, sure. If you guys have the numbers, I might as well grab them.
I came out at 4.16.
Okay.
I'm at 3.44. I'm the outlier here.
not too. I mean, I was 3.88. So it's not too far different. Yeah. Okay. So they go from mirrors to Cultosaurus erectus, and my understanding is that they kind of were kind of aiming back to get more of back to their roots, kind of move away from the pop sensibility of mirrors. Do you feel that they achieved that, or
no?
We got a no. So
I don't. I think these albums, to me, the way I've always considered them, are like, they're like 1A and 1B. I mean, they're like, they kind of come together. They're like it's like a buy one, get one free deal. There's a lot of similarities, I think. I think they sound alike. The production, I think, is similar. It's a slick production. But I think the songs are very comparable. The songs are comparable. I think the records are comparable. I think there's a little bit more of the, maybe more of the fantasy lyrics, perhaps, mm-hmm. like Black Blade, Monsters, maybe. But I think on the whole, they're very comparable. So I'd be interested to hear what you guys have to say if you think there's some differences there. But I think they're pretty compatible. Mm-hmm.
Guys?
Ryan?
I dig this one a lot. This was the first of their albums produced by Martin Birch, who, like, you know, worked with Deep Purple, Fleetwood Mac, and Black mm-hmm. Sabbath, and Iron Maiden mostly. And I think you can hear that. And I don't know. I felt like they got back on track with this one, from my perspective, anyway.
Mm-hmm.
It's very polished. It's very tight. There's some elements of glam rock that creep in too, which I thought was kind of interesting.
Really, where do you hear some of the glam rock? Because I wouldn't have thought of that.
We're probably like Monsters has a little bit of glam rock in it, I think, and jazz for sure, definitely jazz. Yeah, Hungry Boys is a little bit,
maybe a little bit.
Yeah, okay. And unknown tongue is the one I mostly caught the glam rock. I mean, that one I think is probably the most prevalent.
Okay.
Yeah.
Again, now I'm going to go back and listen to it and go, okay, where do I hear the glam rock? You know? Yeah.
Yeah, and they're not doing straight up stuff. It's through the B.O.C. filter, of course. But sure. Like, you know, I thought it was interesting. You know, like, they keep adding all these flavors, trying new things, which just makes them such an interesting band to follow.
Oh yeah.
You
know? But, yeah.
Yeah. But I would not have expected them to take on, you know, to incorporate glam rock in any way.
Jock, like, yeah. Oh, I'm sorry, Brent, go ahead.
No, compare these records with like the first two. I mean, there's
right.
completely different, right? I mean,
completely different.
Nothing to do with the first, and they're, you know, they're good in their own right, but they have nothing to do with those first records.
Yeah.
Now, Josh, you looked like you're contemplating there. What do you?
Well, I mean, it's. I mean, when you say they have nothing to do with the first records, I mean, I think that there's a weird. I think the Boy Oyster Cult is a really singular band. And I definitely think there's an evolution mm-hmm. on these records from those first records. But I mean, it's still this very, like, nobody sounds like them. It's a very singular sound that they have. So I hear an evolution, but I also hear a connection back to those first albums, a line back to those first albums. So
I can hear that.
You know, you've got, I mean, when you look at the stuff off the first album and then you look at a song like Black Blade, it's like, yeah, I can see how they grow into that. You know, I mean, mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a really interesting evolution to me. It's an interesting record. Oddly enough for me, this album scored exactly the same as Mirrors.
Oh, really?
Oh, wow.
Yeah. And I mean, it's like, then which one do I like more? I don't know. These two are, like Brent was saying, like, these two are like almost like 1A and 1B. I do see that. I mean, they are very much companion albums to each other. They're weird and quirky albums, like kind of like everything B.O.C. does is kind of weird and quirky. You know, songs like Black Blade and Monsters. I love that jazz breakdown in Monsters. I've always loved Black Blade. I think that when I was younger, this album kind of got away from me. And there was a lot of stuff outside of those first few songs that I didn't quite get. A song that's really grown on me over the years is The Marshall Plan. That's a five. I absolutely love The Marshall Plan. So, yeah.
Yeah.
See, I personally, I think The Marshall Plan, the most interesting thing to me about it is the play on words. You know, the post-World War II Marshall Plan, you know, George Marshall, Secretary of State, and then of course Marshall amplifiers. Other than that, I personally don't think the song is that interesting. I think it's boring. Having said that, now I'm going to go back and listen to it and go, okay, Josh hears something in this. Yeah. What is it? So I'll give it another chance, although I've heard it 1,000 times, but yeah.
It's like a more literary version of Foreigner's Jukebox Hero.
Okay. I hear it as a sequel to Golden Age of Leather. I don't know why.
Okay.
That's interesting.
I can see that.
To me, what I think is kind of interesting just from the album as a whole is, you know, they switch producers like Brian, like you said, they go to Martin Birch. It's kind of seen as a more of a return to their roots. It's kind of back to a little bit of a darker sensibility. But weirdly enough, I actually agree, Brent, and Josh, I think you said this too, that these two albums kind of go together. I don't know why, but to me, I don't, maybe it's the sound of it, the production. I don't really know what it is, but to me, the other Martin Birch album that comes next sounds to me like more like Martin Birch. I don't know why, but I tend to in my mind, I put Cultosaurus Erectus and Fire of Unknown Origin as a pair because I know Martin Birch produced them. I put Mirrors and Cultosaurus Erectus kind of as a pair more for the feel and the sonics of it. Just my ears. I don't know. Maybe I'm weird like that, but.
Can I give you my high points on the album?
Yeah, yeah.
So this album has 4 5-star songs. Do you want to try to guess those, or should I just tell?
No, I'm gonna guess. Okay. Black there's Blade, five, there's four. There's Black four. Blade, Monsters.
Nope.
Okay, more. Then I'm done. No. Okay, I'm out.
Monster, Hungry Boys, Fallen Angel, Lips in the Hills, and Fallen Angel has I think it's my all-time favorite Buck Dharma guitar solo. That guitar solo just gives chills.
All right, I'm gonna listen to that again because I'm not a fan of Fallen Angel.
Not my favorite.
I like Joe Bouchard's vocal on it, and but Buck's solo, that is just off the rails.
Yeah, it's such a proggy song, which immediately grabs me because I love prog rock so much. And it reminded me of Marillion, so I ended up liking it a lot.
That's interesting. I didn't draw that comparison, but now that you mentioned it, I can see that.
I'm making notes.
Right? I mean, it reminds one of Marillion.
Yeah.
All the more. Now, Brent, you said you gave Hungry Boys a 5?
Absolutely.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow. Wow.
I like that one too.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, it's very upbeat, definitely groovy, very driving.
Had a good driving riff to it. It's got some really sizzling guitar work in it. It's got some nice vocals. Yeah, man. Hell yeah.
I don't know. Maybe it's just me and my maybe the way I reacted to a song 30, 40 years ago, or however long it's been, is clouding my judgment here. Because I gave Hungry Boys a 1.5.
Oh wow!
I
love
that, so.
I gave it a 4. I mean, I wouldn't put it into 5 territory.
Wow!
But I really like that song. It's catchy. Yeah.
It's fantastic.
Maybe there's something wrong here with
get the
Brent, what was that?
And the heaviness of Lips in the Hills, right? I mean, it's funny because like Hungry Boys and Fallen Angels are kind of similar in some ways, but like Lips in the Hills has nothing to do with that. Monsters has, so there's quite a bit of variety. Divine yeah, Wind is a really good record, you know.
Well,
Black Blade, there's a lot of variety on this album, I feel.
I think Divine Wind should get name checked. I think Divine Wind is a really good
album. Absolutely.
That's like their sexy song.
Yeah.
If B.O.C. can be sexy, that's them being sexy.
If they can.
Come on, let's not kid her. They are.
Yeah. I'm going to say, though, Lips in the Hills is...
hot.
That is... If I'm forced to pick one, mm-hmm. that would be the one. It's mm-hmm. Black Blade and Monsters are really, really close behind it, but I give Lips in the Hills a 5. I love that song.
Absolutely.
Just mm-hmm. storming.
It's a good song.
Yeah.
Do you want our numbers?
Sure. Well, I got Josh's.
I'm 4.17 on this one. 4.17 stars average.
Okay. And Brian?
I had a 4.3.
4.3.
Woo! Yeah. It's a big shift. It's a big swing.
Yeah.
Yeah. See,
on this one, I'm the outlier. To me, it's just way too many peaks and valleys. But you know what? You are learned colleagues here, and I will go back for, I don't know what, maybe the 300th listen of that album, because I've listened so many times in my life. But the thing is, we're trying to listen to these with fresh ears, and sometimes I'm not sure if I really am. And sometimes I have to hear what you guys have to say for me to I'll go listen to it again. So,
hopefully anybody watching and listening to this will have a similar experience, and they'd be like, yeah, I thought about that like that.
Right. Exactly. So Fire of Unknown Origin comes back, and as the eighth album in the B.O.C. catalog, the third of our discussion here today. And of course it contains the huge smash hit Burning for You. If I'm correct, though, I mean, yeah, this is again produced by Martin Birch, but if I'm correct, Albert doesn't do any lead vocals on this record. Is that accurate?
I'm not sure.
I don't think he does. I think Joe does one.
Joe does Vengeance, right?
He does Vengeance. He does Vengeance, and the rest of it, I think, is Eric and Buck.
I think you are correct.
So I think that's kind of an unfortunate thing, I think, because I like Albert's voice. But having said that, I think this album is absolutely stellar start to finish.
Me too.
This is one of those albums where it's like, I almost feel like I need to be more critical because I just can't give everything a 5.
Yeah.
I
was in that mode too.
Were you? Okay. Because it's like the secret treaties of the early 80s to me.
Yeah.
Like this, it's like this is Bloister Cult. When I put on Secret Treaties, like that's Bloister Cult.
Yeah.
So
yeah, this is one of my favorites for sure.
Josh?
Yeah, I didn't rate this album very high.
Okay.
I actually think it kind of sucks.
Oh, sure.
I don't really like it. There's
I'm
not
sure
really
that you're being
songs on here I listen to or like that much. I it's kind of a throwaway record for me. You know, okay, seriously, I think this is the jewel of their discography. I always kind of wonder. I always kind of have this whole debate about it. There's like three possible Desert Island albums from Oyster Cult. And, you know, I always go, is it Secret Treaties? Is it Fire of Unknown Origin? Is it Imaginos? I think what I'm kind of learning is it's Fire of Unknown Origin. This album, this had, for me, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 five-star songs. Mm-hmm. And it rated really high. I mean, it's just, this album just sounds like 1980. I think 81, the album came out in 81, I think. This just has that 1981 sound. Great year for music. Just a perfect time capsule for that year and that time. And it's just, absolutely love this record.
Yeah.
Not just one of my favorite Bloister Cult records, one of my favorite records of all time.
Mm-hmm.
John, Can you tell me which what your five star songs are?
Why don't you tell me what my five star songs are, sir?
Yeah.
You want me to guess?
Yeah, I do want you to guess. And you better get them right.
The title track?
No.
Okay, then I'm off. So just go ahead and tell me.
Well, that was very anticlimactic. Veteran of the Psychic Wars is a 5. Okay. Yeah. Soul Survivor is a 5. Heavy Metal's a 5. Vengeance of the Pact is a 5. Okay. After Dark is a 5. And Don't Turn Your Back's a 5.
Okay. Wow. All right.
Okay. The title track is a 4.5.
So Josh, I'm basically in almost an agreement with you on all of that. To me, it's like, oh shoot, is this a 5 or is this a 4.5? And it's like, oh
yeah,
you know.
The big hit single, Burning for You, I don't hate that song.
Mm-hmm.
It's kind of the low point. It's a good song. I mean, it's definitely a very commercial, it's that hit single we were talking about that was not on Mirrors. I gave it a 3.5. It's definitely not a bad song, but I mean, honestly, in this set of songs, it's probably the least interesting song on the record, I think.
And that one, I still like it when I hear it on the radio. And I've heard it how many thousands of times? Mm-hmm. And I still like when it comes on, I go,
oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm. I do, too. I do, too.
Yeah, definitely.
Brent, get in here on this one.
You might want to have Bryon go first and then I'll wrap up.
Okay. Bryon, do you, okay, let's flip this around. Since Josh just mentioned Burning for You is a low point for him on this record, are there any low points for you or is this just all sky high?
My lowest one was probably Don't Turn Your Back. I thought that was the weakest song on the album and I still gave it a 4.3. So, but compared to everything else for me, it was the lowest of it. And I still love it. So,
I just
even that song is groovy and interesting and has like cool vocal harmonies on it and everything. So, you know, it's still not a slacker, but in comparison to the other songs,
I love that early 80s keyboard in After Dark.
Oh, yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
It's like,
yeah. Me too. God,
that's so cool.
It's such a ghoulish sounding song too.
Oh, I know.
It just makes me want to wear a cape.
Yeah,
I just want to put a cape on every time I hear that song.
Yes.
Yeah, like your inner Rick Wakeman.
Right. or Eric Bloom. I mean, he wore a cape in the early days.
He did.
He's on the back cover of Tyranny and Mutation. He's got that.
Yeah.
On the remastered, but. Personally, I don't think you can go wrong with any of these. It's really hard. My lowest score on here is a 4. I gave Burning for You a 4. Mm-hmm. I gave Fire of Unknown Origin a 4. And I don't know if you guys are aware of this. Did you know that Fire of Unknown Origin was originally written for Agents of Fortune?
Yes.
Yeah, because it has the Patti Smith lyric writing credit on it.
Yeah.
And that was back when they were working with her.
Yeah. So you do, I have that remastered version that of Agents of Fortune that has the demo.
Oh wow! Okay.
Yeah, it's they improved on it. I'll put it that way. But
they definitely did.
Yeah. So it's
it was a good move.
Yeah. But you know, when a low point on an album is a 4, it's like Josh said, it's like it's not just it could be a desert island album. Period. You know. And to me, the real question then becomes like, because I, you know, in our last set, Secret Treaties was my number one. And the question is like, well, how does this stack up against Secret Treaties? So, yeah, Brent, you were kind of waiting for.
Well, it's interesting because I completely disagree with you guys and I'm not being sarcastic.
Really?
This album does not.
Should we just eject you from this conversation right now? You're not entitled to have an opinion.
I have a record is 3-star songs. I have one 5-star song, which is Vengeance, which might be my all-time favorite Blue Oyster Cult song. I will say that.
Okay.
That might be my
favorite. It's a great riff.
Oh, yeah. And the bridge gives me chills.
Yeah.
Heavy Metal, I really like that. I almost gave it a 5, but I gave it a 4. Burning for You is catchy. Is it overplayed? Sure. It's still a good song. I'm not going to knock it because it gets played on the radio. So I gave that a 4. The rest of the album just, it's kind of blah for me. I can't really explain it.
Veteran of the Psychic Wars doesn't do anything for you?
No.
No. Really? I gave that, what'd you give it?
3.
Okay, so you're still saying it's not like it's a bad song, though.
No, just... no. Everything else is, yeah. There are 5 3s, and I gave the title track a 3.5. So I don't hate the record, but compared to the comments you guys have made.
Where are you on, and anybody, I mean, this is open to anybody, but where are you on, like, Soul Survivor?
Love 3. It. 5. 3.
That's a 4.6.
I did 4.5. And I gave another one is Joan Crawford. I mean,
yeah,
God,
I think it's weird and proggy.
Yeah.
Only Blue Oyster Cult could do that song. I mean, it's no one else can do that.
And they made creepy and proggy,
and they made a video for it. I mean, now I gave it a 3. So the way I do this, if it's a 3, it's a good song. Mm-hmm. If you get one. Oh, 3. There are things about it that I don't like. I actively dislike.
Yeah.
So, record, there's nothing that I dislike. But when you compare this for me mm-hmm. with Bears and Cultosaurus, it just doesn't stack up.
That's interesting. And
yeah.
If everybody saw the same stuff the same way, then what would be the point of having the conversation? Right. I think it's interesting. I didn't realize. I mean, hell, you and I have known each other since I was born.
This is true.
And I didn't know that you had this opinion of this album until now. Again, not that you're saying it's a bad record. It's just not as...
No.
Yeah.
No. My app, 3.5 stars. So there's my number, 3.5.
The differences in opinion are interesting.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you're still wrong, Brent. So you know you're still wrong about it. But,
Yeah. By the way, I think the thing that's kind of creepy to me about Joan Crawford is, you know, I mean, her reputation, of course, with, you know, the Mommy Dearest and that film and everything. My understanding is that some of the claims about Joan Crawford were either made up or blown out of proportion or exaggerated. There's some controversy about whether or not those that I think it comes from her daughter's accounts of her life. And
yeah, her daughter wrote Mommy Dearest, so yeah.
Okay.
I mean Mommy Dearest, I guess. Yeah.
Yeah. And I guess there's been some pushback against some of her claims in that, and it's like, wow, man, what a way to have your, you know, if it's true that those claims are exaggerated, then it's like, wow, what a way to have your reputation. Not only, you know, does it get into a book and then a movie, but then Blue Oyster Cult comes along and makes a great song out of it. You know?
Long hairs.
She rose from the grave. She rose from the grave.
Well, that's right. She did. Yeah, right. Okay. You know, I think I don't have anything else to say other than I absolutely love this record. So last thoughts before we move along to Revolution by Night.
Do you want my number?
Oh yeah, sure.
4.66.
Okay. And Brent?
3.50.
Okay. And Bryon?
4.7.
Okay. Righty-o. Cool. So they follow up, which, by the way, that then is the last album with the original lineup of Bloister Call, because Albert is cast aside, and his drum tech, Rick Downey, isn't that correct? Wasn't Rick Downey Albert's drum tech?
Yes.
Okay. So he gets brought in on the tour, and he's on the Extraterrestrial Live, and then he plays on Revolution by Night. And just as a side note, I think they are both on the upcoming and apparently final Bloister Called album that comes out in another month or so, Ghost Stories. So which I'm looking forward to. But to me, Revolution by Night, and it's like I'm kind of drawing a blank. Oh, Bruce Fairbairn produced this.
Yeah. from Bon Jovi and Aerosmith fame. He did their biggest albums.
Right. So in that point, in as a producer in his career, he hadn't quite hit his big, huge, like you say, Bon Jovi, Aerosmith stuff. Because this is 83, right? Yeah, this is 83.
Yes, the latter. He did Kiss's Psycho Circus later.
Yep. To me, Revolution by Night feels more like Cultosaurus Erectus.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It doesn't have that kind of weird lushness. There's kind of a lush quality to Fire of Unknown Origin. I think Revolution by Night sounds, it's back to a little bit of a brighter, crisper sound from a production standpoint. And I also don't think, and again, this is just me, because to me, Cultosaurus was much more of a peaks and valleys kind of record. And to me, Revolution by Night is back to that kind of peaks and valleys thing. But I do think some of the peaks are just outstanding. And there's a couple of interesting little bits too. Even though Joe Bouchard is on the record, Randy Jackson of what's that TV show with the American Idol. Yeah, he played bass on Shooting Shark.
Which he also played bass for Journey. I think he played on Raised on Radio.
I think so. Yeah. Yeah.
Great bass player.
Yeah. And Take Me Away, opening the album with Aldo Nova.
Yeah, Aldo Nova was a weird foil to bring into the songwriting process.
Right. But I love Take Me Away. I think the riff under the guitar solo in Take Me Away is just, it's like, I don't even listen to the solo. It's like, that's one of those guitar solos where it's all about, to me, it's all about the riff underneath it. And I think there's some great highs on it. I think Take Me Away is fantastic. I love Shooting Shark and I love Shadow of California. That riff in Shadow of California, right after that whole like Into the Darkness part, Into the Darkness, and then it comes in with that dun 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 dun. That is just like the hair stand up. I absolutely love that. And Neil Smith from the Alice Cooper Band co-wrote that song. So I think kind of an interesting thing. There were a few surprises to me on this record. I go back and I kind of go, I forgot how much I actually like Feel the Thunder. I think Veins is usually a song I look at and kind of go, that's just too corny. But then I listen to it and it's like, yeah, it's better than I tend to give it credit for.
That ended up being a gem for me. Actually,
Veins did?
I'd forgotten about it too.
Yeah. It's so quirky, and it's not a five for me, but it's definitely not as, I shouldn't skip it, and put it that way,
It's got a ripping soap.
it does. But then you get the tail end of the album for me, just kind of like Let Go. I can't.
I can't either.
It's co-written with Ian Hunter.
They're chanting their name in the song. That's as corny as it gets.
Exactly. Yeah.
I can be what you want to be. B.O.C.
We
have the power, but we got the key.
Yeah. I felt they should be above that kind of thing at this point in their career. Is how I felt about that song.
That's a good way to put it. Yeah.
We should never do that. You're telling me. Ever do. Okay.
Right. No, no band should ever do that, really. And I just think Light Years of Love, my note just simply says boring with like five O's.
I don't think it's bad.
I just think it's boring. So I gave that a two. Yeah. But
I don't think his vocal pulls it off on that one. I think he's singing outside of his range a little bit or something because it sounds off.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. It's like he's straining to those high notes in the choruses. Yeah. And that song is boring. I agree.
Yeah.
To me, it's a better album than I remember it, but it's still a peaks and valleys kind of album. A few songs I absolutely love. And then, like I said, it kind of a few sleepers, a few surprises, but then it kind of tails off. So,
Yeah. I think overall, I would like the thing I don't like about Bruce Fairbairn's production work on this is the guitars sound a little more muted, and not as present than they do on the other. Like, there's some great playing going on there, but the guitars feel like they're mixed too low or something, or they're not. I don't know. There's something I don't really dig on the guitar production, which is too bad. Bruce Fairbairn's a great producer and stuff. I feel bad, like I'm dissing him. And
Yeah,
you'd mentioned he
definitely.
worked on Yes is the Ladder.
Yep.
He passed away during that. John Anderson found him
Yeah.
dead,
Yep.
actually. He was the first one to find him, so
Yeah.
which is
And
that's a sad
I know
story.
we're not on a Yes conversation here,
Right.
but I love the ladder
Oh,
myself.
I do too.
Yeah.
We should do a
So
Yes one.
yes.
Question:
We
rank
could do
the
that. Might
Yes
take a while. There's a lot of albums in there.
albums.
But I'm open for that, absolutely. I don't know, Josh, Brent.
Josh,
Brent,
I'll let
I
you
really
go.
want to know what you think about this album before I talk.
Me?
Yeah,
Me?
you.
Oh,
it's a trap.
So I agree, guys, that okay, the only song on the record that I gave less than a 3 is Light Years of Love. I gave that a 2.5. I was probably generous. My favorite song on the record is Take Me Away. It's got a fantastic video. If people haven't seen the video, you should.
The video is
The video.
phenomenal. If you're watching this and you haven't seen the video for Take Me Away, go out to YouTube and look it up. Best music video ever,
It's one of the
except
great.
for Buck Darva's Born to Rock. That's the best video ever. And then Oyster Cult's Take Me Away. Those are the two greatest music videos of all time.
I
Okay,
can't
cool.
really agree with my colleague. I think he summed it up very well. Great video. So I give that a 5. Shooting Shark is a 5. I love Veins. I gave that a 4. And then I give Shadow of California a 3.5. The rest of the record is kind of a 3. You know, Feel the Thunder, Let Go, Dragon Lady, Eyes on Fire. Those don't do a whole lot for me. They're not bad, but interestingly, I gave this album on the whole a little bit better grade than I gave Fire of Unknown Origin.
Interesting.
I do agree with Brian's comment about the production. I think the guitars are just a little dull.
Yeah.
And the drums
It's
are very 80s.
yeah.
And
But
that's
so what,
so
Brent, what did you give Let Go?
three.
Really?
Yeah.
I gave it a 1.5.
I was probably generous. I can handle it because it is catchy. It's not, again, I'm not really into the lyrics. You guys know I'm
It's
not
the
really into
lyrics.
I'm not into the lyrics as much as the melody. And I actually like the music. I think the music's pretty cool, and I don't mind that. The cheesiness, I get it. I probably could have been a little harsher on it, but
Well, but you know what? Look, here's the deal. Shells and cheese is a thing, right? And Velveeta, it has its
Well,
there are some people that just swear by it, you know?
Yep, there's
I
a
don't want
time and a place.
Well, I don't want it to clog my arteries, but I do like a healthy dose. You do get a good deal of it on this record. Brian, you made a good point about that rolling riff in Shadow of California. I agree with that. And you made a great point about the underlying riff on the guitar solo on Take Me Away. Fantastic. But yeah, I quite like I enjoy this record. It's a fun record. I think Fire of Unknown Origin comes off as a little more serious. I think one of you guys mentioned earlier this is kind of them kind of just being a little more quirky and fun, maybe. And I think that comes off with songs, maybe. There, Josh.
Josh, you hate this record?
I don't hate it. It's a big drop off for me. You know, it starts off perfect. Take Me Away is actually one of my favorite B.O.C. songs, not to mention the video. But one of my favorite, that's a 5. There's no other 5s in the album for me. Shooting Shark's really good. I give it a 4.5. Amazing bass work by Randy Jackson. You know, there aren't a lot of high points on there. I mean, there's a lot of middle of the road stuff. I mean, it's okay. I'm not a big Feel the Thunder guy. I gave that a 2.5 because it's just not huge veins. I was generous and gave it a 3.5. It's not really one of my favorites. The other high point on the album for me is Let Go. Okay, I'm sorry. I love that song, and I gave it a 4. And you can be what you want to be.
You
We got
got
the
the
power, man. We
power.
got the
We
key.
got the key.
I mean, I think that's fantastic, and I'm so glad they did it. And I listen to that song when I'm having a bad day. I put that on, and I dance around my house.
Yeah.
Okay.
Cool.
Or I swerve around the interstate.
That is. And you,
that's just what that song does to me. And so if you ever see me swerving around, you know I'm having a bad day and I'm listening to Let Go.
Okay. And you wish as good a lyricist as they were on that song. You wish you could write lyrics that good. I know.
I can't. You can't.
They can't.
It's an impossibility, apparently.
Correct. So that's my take on it. The album scored quite a bit lower, 3.6. So it's a big drop off from the previous records. It just isn't really there for me. It's mm-hmm. just not as interesting. It's very middle of the road.
At 3. That's funny, Josh, because I'm at 3.56. You actually scored it higher than I did.
Wow.
More than you. That's interesting.
Interesting. That is interesting. Brian, what did you score it overall?
I'm at 4.3.
Wow.
Interesting.
Wow.
You actually scored it higher than the rest of us. I mean, assuming, of course, that Let Go is a 5 for you.
actually, I gave it a 3 because it was a little bit of a pity point kind of a thing. But with it nestled between everything the way that it is, I was like, you know, the other songs kind of pull it up a little bit. And I try not to rank it based on production because that's time, like we were talking about before. It's, sure. They can't help. That was the production style at the time. You know?
Yeah. Yeah. What would you... I thought
there's a lot of good high points on it. Like Shooting Shark reminds me a little bit of like King Crimson or something with that cool bass.
Good song.
That's a really cool song. Veins, you know, I love it. Eyes on Fire has the piano bits and some really cool atmosphere. Shadow of California is like that. That's like a proper metal tune, I think.
Is it like a biker song? Is that what that is, kind of? Or is it Feel the Thunder? Biker song.
Feel the Thunder, I think, would be... Now, I got a question about Eyes on Fire. I mean, it's kind of a middle-of-the-road song for me, but it was written by an outside writer, Greg Winter, and I don't mm-hmm. know much about him. I mean, there's...
I don't know who that is either.
And there's no hyperlink on Wikipedia. So it's like he doesn't even have a Wikipedia page, and it's like,
wow.
I don't know. Can I get a song on a Bloister called album? You know, you know, maybe. But interesting though. I'm kind of surprised, Brian, because you look like you outranked it compared to the rest of us. But it'll be interesting to see when we do the countdown how it all kind of shakes out. But
yeah,
yeah. Okay, it's to me it's kind of it's I find it a little strange to me that Cultosaurus Erectus, which I think is a peaks and valleys kind of record, and then you have this masterpiece to me of Fire of Unknown Origin, and then followed by another peaks and valleys record. But then again, I mean, like Brent, you know, your views are quite a bit different than mine on that, and so. It's just interesting how we see these albums and what they mean to us, how we react to them. So,
yeah, I feel like side one is the peak and side two is the valley.
Yeah, that's yes, that's a really good way to put
it. There's good things in the valley too, but like
that's so if side one is the peak and side two is the valley, then it's just like right. That, right? It's just
kind of a slope.
The whole thing is a slope. Then we move along to Club Ninja, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Uh-huh. Now Club Ninja is produced by Sandy Pearlman, and mm-hmm. you know, you would think, I would think at a glance, you'd be like, oh, okay, now we're getting back to, you know, really to their roots, to the early days, kind of, you know, maybe not sonically because it is the mid 80s, but you'd think that there would be some sort of, like, I don't know, kind of bringing things back home, a kind of a mm-hmm. let's bring back home kind of a mentality. But it's not. It's really more of a let's look for outside writers. You know, White Flags has outside writers. Dance in the Ruins has outside writers. Make Rock Not Wars, Bob Halligan Jr., which I think his songs he gave to Judas Priest are far better than Make Rock Not War. Mm-hmm. But, you know, he also wrote Beat 'Em Up, which to me, a song like Beat 'Em Up sounds like, I mean, It sounds like it should be on a film soundtrack to some cheesy 80s movie. There's not a whole lot about this album I think is that great. It's also it's Buck. Rick Downey's gone on drums. It's Tommy Price on drums, and keyboard player replaces Alan Lanier. Tommy Zvonchek. I apologize if I'm saying his name incorrectly. But yeah, it's like they're in salvage mode almost. And it's like, well, we gotta put an album out. We gotta try to stay relevant. The 80s just doesn't seem like it's an era that's very welcoming or of the Blue Oyster Cult kind of mentality. The band itself is kind of falling apart. It seems like they're just kind of taping things together. What are your overall thoughts on this one?
I agree with the whole bringing in co-writers thing, but they had Jim Carroll wrote, helped write Perfect Water, which I thought was pretty cool. He's a celebrated poet, so like mm-hmm. Getting him, and you mentioned him earlier.
Yeah, and within the
And Shadow Warrior, the co-writer on that, Eric Van Lustbader. He's the guy. He was a fantasy sci-fi author who's friends with Elton John, and he continued writing the Bourne novels after Robert Ludlum quit writing them. He wrote 11. Mm-hmm. He wrote 11 Jason Bourne novels, which I thought that's kind of badass. But how is he showing up on a B.O.C. album? I don't know.
Howard Stern shows up on this album
too. Yeah.
Oh, that's right. I forgot about the Howard Stern. Yeah.
that spoken word.
Everybody's on it.
Which I think is kind of cheese. Myself, but and I guess to a certain degree we can't knock him too much because going all the way back to day one, I mean lyrically they were not much. I mean, they always had kind of this outside, whether it's Patti Smith or Sandy Pearlman or whatever, but it really seems like even on the music side, a couple of Bob Halligan songs, White Flags Day, although I think Danced in the Ruins is actually one of the best songs on the record.
I think
Perfect Water is a really, really good song. I really like Perfect Water. I give that a 4. I give Dance in the Ruins a 3.5. But man, Beat 'Em Up.
Yeah, I have a hard time with it.
To me, that's a 1. And When the War Comes, I give it a 1.5. It's just not.
Beat 'Em Up has the lyric, "Takes the licking, but keep on ticking," which is the Energizer Bunny, like,
right.
It's like you're scraping the barrel a little bit there when you're doing battery commercial.
I don't know. Could they use that in an Energizer commercial then? Maybe.
Maybe that was the goal.
maybe it was.
So would you guys agree they're kind of running on fumes at this point? Brian, you mentioned taping things together, and I think probably a fair assessment of this record, and I know we'll kind of get to how we look at the numbers and whatnot, but yeah, it's like they're just running on vapors at this point, unfortunately.
And this one, I agree with you that I think they were running on fumes, but this is the one for me that came out right when I had discovered B.O.C. and was getting heavily into them. This was the new one that came out, and so I was so excited. So I have like nostalgia filters.
Yeah,
it was the first new B.O.C. album in my lifetime that had come out that I was aware of, so to me I was very excited about it. So all my numbers are completely biased and skewed as a result.
And
talked about that is a real thing. We're you try to push that aside, but it's so hard.
That was my experience. I have no choice.
A few specific things on this. I made some notes here. I do think that the solo, guitar solo on Spy in the House of the Night is really good. And my note here says Spy in the House of Love on Morrison Hotel. I wonder if there's some sort of, influential element. Yeah. What I should do, I should have done this as prep work, but I failed to. I apologize. But Martin Popoff's Agents of Fortune, the Oyster Cult story. Really good book about Oyster Cult. It's a second edition of a book that he'd written earlier. But I should go back and read the chapter on Club Ninja, because sometimes it's these weird albums or the less successful ones that are almost more interesting from a kind of a biographical standpoint. It's like, what are they going through? What are they dealing with, etc. My note for Beat 'Em Up says, sounds like it's written for a bad, cheesy, low budget sci-fi flick starring puppets.
Yeah. It's very specific. Right.
And
my note just says yuck. That's all mine says.
And I also made a note of the drum sound on Shadow Warrior. It just says drums sound suddenly sucks even more. So apparently I'm not real thrilled with the drum sound on the entire record, but
not a particularly good sounding array. It's very much a product of time, right? Mid-80s production values and all that stuff, and the synths. It kind of waters it down a little bit.
Well, but like we said before, there's good cheese and bad cheese, and sometimes you're in the mood for Velveeta. It's just kind of the way it rolls. But I'm rarely in the mood for Club Ninja, I have to say.
I don't, even though I have the nostalgia for it, I don't pull it out very often either.
Yeah,
I do like I like the cover. So I did some research on that. Can you hold up the cover again?
Quick? Yeah, yeah.
The guy that did that is Don Ivan Punchatz is his name, and unsurprisingly, he did a bunch of fantasy and sci-fi work, including like Heavy Metal magazine, stuff like that. But he also did the box art for the first Doom game
when it came out. Oh, no kidding.
Yeah, so if you look at that cover, you can kind of squint a little bit and imagine the cover of Doom with that guy coming at you and all that stuff, and you can kind of see the style in it. I thought that was an interesting bit of trivia.
Yeah, I like that, those little bits of trivia. I think it just kind of adds color to all of this. So yeah, do you get the sense that they were really just trying to stay afloat and aiming for sales here? Is that kind of the overall vibe you get from the record? Or
I think they were trying kind of, but I think they were mostly trying to just stay relevant and during that, like you mentioned, that time, they weren't really welcome during that time, it didn't feel like. So
no, and this is 86.
Mm-hmm.
My first Oyster Cult show was, I don't know, Brian, do you remember down by the Des Moines airport, there was the club, The Runway? Did you ever see any shows at The Runway? They basically just, they were playing a bar, and that would have been around 90 or so. So, only a few years after this, and it was,
good for you, but
right, yeah. For me overall, this album came out at a 2.44, so
pretty bad.
That's pretty low.
How about you guys?
Well, go ahead, Brian, since you guys, go ahead and give your
I gave it a 4 for purely nostalgic purposes.
Sure.
Gotcha. I'll own that.
Josh, do you want to say anything, or do you want me to go first?
Well, you go first, but I do want to say something.
Okay. I don't have a whole lot to say. It's all pretty much been said. I don't dig this album out that often either. Although I will say that Spine in the House of the Night is a gem for me. That's a 5-star song. I love that song. I think that song's amazing. I like Dancing in the Ruins a lot. I give that a 5 too. And I give Perfect Water 4. The rest of the albums, I gave Beat 'Em Up a 2. I was generous, I think. Rest of the record, I give it to 3. It's like I can handle it. Is it really bad? Maybe. I mean, on another day, I might rate some of those songs a little bit lower, but it's kind of forgettable. Mm-hmm. I mean, I think the best song in the record is "Spy in the House of the Night." And I'm, and having gone through this exercise, I kind of refamiliarized myself with how much I like that song.
Yeah.
The rest of it, eh.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so, I agree with you though. I think it's a good song. I think Perfect Water is a good, really good song. So yeah.
I average with 3.44.
Okay.
I agree with a lot of what you guys are saying about the record and about, where they were at as a band and so forth. But I think that, unlike you guys, and I've always kind of had a I have the same nostalgia thing because it was the new B.O.C. album when I got into it as well. Totally get that. I remember having it on vinyl. But it's kind of been relegated to, I don't listen to this very often. But unlike you guys, I actually have really enjoyed it. I've listened to it several times over the last week. I actually think it's a better record than people give it credit for. It actually scored better than Revolution by Night for me. It does not have a 5 on it, but what that means is it's a much more consistent album. Like, I think it's pretty consistent all the way through, and I find it interesting. Unlike you guys, again, I quite like Beat 'Em Up. I think it's a fun song. It's corny as hell. It does sound like it could be in some 80s kung fu movie or perhaps a commercial for batteries. But I love it. I don't care what anybody says. I love that song. That's a song I listen to when I'm having a really good day. So, you know, I like this album. I think it's a fun record to listen to. Scored a 3.7. So not their best work by any means, but not as bad as I remember.
Okay. Not as bad. Interesting. Interesting. Well, okay. You know, do you guys have, your props? Do you have albums?
My props.
Or?
Got my props.
For a countdown?
Yep.
I've just got to grab my.
I don't have my props today. I'm sorry.
No, that's okay. That's,
you can
that's
verbal
okay.
Props.
You can verbalize it. You can verbalize it. Not a problem. I'm just going to take a quick second here. Yeah, okay, that's what I thought. Right. Okay, so we have these five albums. This would be the 6th, 7th, 8th, 9th, and 10th Oyster Cult albums. And in the 5 spot for us, and then like I said, Brian, you can just go ahead and just verbalize it as we do this. For me, it's Club Ninja.
We're doing the lowest to the highest.
Lowest to highest, yeah.
Hello? Looks like Mirrors was my lowest.
Well, based on the number that you gave me, that's correct. So, yeah, Brent, you and I both say Club Ninja is the lowest. Josh, you had what? Revolution by Night, and then and Brian, you said Mirrors.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Okay. In my number 4 spot for me is Cultosaurus Erectus. Oh, and Josh, here's Club Ninja. Brent is Fire of Unknown Origin. That's
Blows my mind.
Mine's Club Ninja as well.
Okay. And Brent's just wrong.
Is he? Really?
Yeah, right. In the number 3 spot for me is Revolution by Night. No.
Same.
Brent, you're right.
Yeah, I'm right.
You now you're right, Brent.
I know.
I've got a tie between Revolution by Night and Cultosaurus Erectus.
Josh, there's a tie between these two, and I don't know if I could pick between these two albums. They're so close.
So you're going to hold them back up again for number 2?
I am. Yes, okay. I'm going to do that.
And the number 2 spot for me is Mirrors.
Cultosaurus.
Huh. So Brent and Josh, you guys kind of agree with each other.
Although yeah.
And Brian, what was your number 2 spot?
Well, I had the Cultosaurus Erectus and Revolution by Night tie. So I guess
that's right.
Yeah, whichever one you want to put in there.
Yeah, whichever. Right. That's right. Yeah. Cultosaurus and Revolution by Night. And number 1 for me.
Same. Is...
yeah.
So for me, pretty wide margin.
Yeah. Yeah. That's interesting. So, so 3 of us say Fire of Unknown Origin of these. They're kind of their middle period, so to speak, in terms of their recording output. And then Brent, you say Mirrors, but you know, I mean, I think you can make an argument for Mirrors. It's a really, really strong record. Mm-hmm. So, Anyway, I think I learned some things talking to you guys about this, and I'm gonna go back and listen to with some fresh ears. And we have our part three is gonna be Imaginos, and Heaven Forbid, Curse of the Hidden Mirror, and The Symbol Remains, which just came out a couple years ago. And we could wait until the new album Ghost Stories comes out and throw that into the mix if you guys think I'd that's say we appropriate.
Do.
Okay,
so let's we have do it. I like that idea.
Okay, let's do that. And then also, if you want to do, not necessarily as part of the rankings, but there's Bad Channels, the soundtrack, and there's a couple of quote unquote new songs on that, and the re-recordings of on the Cult Classic compilation. So, if people have some thoughts about those particular,
okay,
things, we could kind of throw that into the discussion, but not necessarily work it in as part of the ranking. We'll just keep the ranking for Imaginos, Heaven Forbid, Hidden Mirror, Symbol Remains, and the upcoming Ghost Stories. So, okay. How's that sound to you guys?
Sounds great.
Okay, cool. I got nothing else. If you're watching this and you're still with us, thank you. Bless you. You're amazing. And feel free to put a comment, subscribe, ring the little bell, do whatever, all that stuff. And check out Hair Metal Memories, the podcast. Check out some Strong Like Bear. Check out our new track that we'll post below. And that's it for me. You guys have any last comments?
I'm just going to swerve around on the road and listen to Beat 'Em Up.
Make sure you're listening to Let Go.
Oh, Let Go. Sorry.
Well, that's okay.
Yeah. I couldn't tell if I was having a good day or a bad day.
Okay. Until next time.
I don't remember what it was.
Say what?
I don't even remember what song was I talking about when I was swerving around.
I don't know. All right, guys. I think I'm going to go eat a pizza.
Sounds like a plan.
Okay. Thanks, guys. See you later.
Thanks, guys.
Bye.